Hi folks, my name is Hector Atlas and welcome to another explanatory video by Peaky Boardgamer. In today's menu we have the game Faiyum, designed by Friedman Friese. Friedman Friese has designed many other famous titles like Power Grid and Factory Manager and many other. However, I think that Mr. Friese has surpassed himself in this one. The game is played with 1 to 5 players. One would say that it uses quite old school mechanics that I really look forward to explaining, so let's not lose more time and start. Place the board in the middle of the table and then add one crocodile on each purple and yellow hex on the board. Create the following supplies next to the board. You have building blocks, settlements, workshops and extensions, towns, roads, bridges, grand bridges, palaces and workers. All of these components are limited to the numbers there are in the box. On the other hand, you have resources such as roses, stones, grains, grapes, fish, and of course dollars, which are not limited. Place a starting settlement on the red space and a road on the dam connecting the two peninsulas. Take the cards of the game, and according to the back illustration of the cards, you must find and separate from the normal cards the 5 starting player sets, as well as the administration cards, and set them all aside for now. Now flip the normal cards to the other side, and you must further separate these cards to blue and yellow. Some of the yellow cards depict the player count illustration in the bottom left corner of the card, showing whether the card will be used or not. Now, if there is such an illustration on the card and your player count is not included, then the card must return to the box. In this example, if you're not playing with 5 players, then the card returns to the box. You should have now 8 yellow cards, set them aside for now. The blue cards should be shuffled to create a face-down stack. Draw the 12 top cards from this stack and sort them according to this number. Then fill all the spaces in the market using the 8 cards with the lowest numbers in an ascending order from bottom to top. So I will place here number 8, 10, 14, 32, 34, 58, 76 and 82. The 4 remaining cards should be examined by all players and then they should be shuffled with the yellow 8 cards to form a final turn stack. We have just created 2 markets, the current market and the future market. Place 1 discount marker to each card in the current market. Each player selects one of the colors and gets the starting set of 5 cards and the 2 markers of the corresponding color, as well as an administration card. Select the player at random to be the starting player, here the green player, and that player starts with $3. The second and the third players start the game with $4, and if there was a fourth and the fifth player, they would start with $5. Here we have a reputation scoring track. Each player places his reputation marker in space 0 of this track, and their 50-100 reputation marker in this space here. The game is now ready to start. In Faiyum, players take the role of the pharaoh's advisors, trying to transform this swampland to a farmland. In this game, players are trying to accumulate reputation, which they track with their marker. Players gain reputation and other resources by playing cards. Players start the game with 5 cards, but they will be buying more cards from the current market throughout the game. Now, on their turn, players usually play 1 card on top of their discard pile, which is personal, meaning that no other player may take their cards. And there is a certain mechanism that allows players to take back cards from their discard pile to their hand so that they may replay them. By playing these cards, the player is after the bonuses in the green area of the card. However, to be able to play the card, you must at first be able to perform the task depicted in the top part of the card. In this example, the player must place 1 worker on 1 settlement that has no worker on. The map is made by hexagons which form 2 peninsulas that are only connected by this bridge here. We have white hexagons connected to stone, yellow hexagons connected to grain, and purple hexagons connected to grapes. All of the hexes are undeveloped with the exception of the red hex, which contains an initial settlement, the 4 brown building sites, and these 2 white hexes that are connected by a bridge. All undeveloped hexes may be developed, but only if they do not contain a crocodile. Crocodile hexes are swamps, and they may only be developed if the crocodile is removed. But what makes an undeveloped hex to become developed? Building a settlement makes the hex developed, or building a workshop makes the hex developed as well. Also, a road develops the two hexes it connects, and the same counts when placing a bridge. A settlement may be further upgraded to a town, as well as the workshop may be further upgraded with an extension. A town is also a settlement, so if a card directed the player to place a worker in a town, then the only option is here. But if the card said place a worker in a settlement, then both of these options are valid. Placement of workers does not make the hexagon developed. Also, workers may be placed in hexagons with crocodiles. Whenever we place workers, we place them upright and never lying down. Another important rule about workers is that there can only be one worker on any hex. Building blocks are placed in building sites and only if they do not exceed the number depicted on the site. Roads may continue another road or start from a settlement or a building site. Also, roads may only be branched in settlements or in building site hexes. So after a player places this road here, no player may place another road there. As I said, this may only happen in settlement or in building sites. Also, players gain one reputation points whenever they connect by road a settlement to a building site or two building sites or two settlements together. Last but not least, crocodiles are removed from the board by playing cards that depict these crocodile icons. After the player removes a crocodile from the board, he gains $1 from the supply. All of the actions that I generally explained are directed by cards that the players will be playing. Nothing on the board belongs to any player. Players just follow the directions of the cards in order to be able to perform the bonuses depicted in the bottom. With all these general rules in mind, we may proceed and explain how the game is actually played, which is very simple. The game starts with the first player, who takes the first turn and then continues in a clockwise manner. On your turn, you have three options and you need to choose one of them. Your first option is to play a card from your hand on top of your discard pile. So the next time the player plays a card, he should place it like that. The order of the cards in the discard pile must never change. The players also keep their hands secret from other players. The second option is to buy a card from the current market, and the third one is to perform administration. Administration is a process that is also described on the player's administration card. After the player executes one of these three options, it's the next player's turn. Now let's take things from the beginning, starting with a play a card action. When a player plays a card from his hand on his discard pile, he has two options again. The first option is to perform the action on the card. To do so, the player must be able to perform the action described in the top part of the card in full. Then the player must be able to pay the resource-related cost in the red area, if there is any, with his own personal resources. And finally, he gains the bonuses depicted in the green area. When it comes to resource costs, there are a couple of rules that need to be mentioned now. First of all, we have roses that act as a wild, so if I need to pay a stone, which I don't have, I could pay with a rose. The second rule is that whenever you need to pay resource costs, you may replace spending of one basic resource with spending $3. So if I had to pay a stone, instead of spending my rose, I could spend three of my dollars. Important, you can only use money to pay for basic resources, stone, grain, and grapes, and you can only pay for one resource at max. So if I had to pay two stones, I would have to use my rose as well. I could not pay with $6. Your second option when playing a card is to skip everything described on the card and simply collect $2 from the bank. Let's explain some basic iconography on the cards to help you further. Most cards depict an arrow pointing from outside to a specific hex. These arrows mean that the player must place the depicted type of component from the supply to the depicted type of hex. This one adds building blocks to building sites. This one adds roads. This one adds a workshop on a grain hex. This one adds a worker on a settlement, etc. We have also arrows pointing outwards, which means that the player must remove the depicted component. Last but not least, we have these arrows denoting that the player moves a component which is already on the board. The multiplier denotes how many times the action must be performed. Most of them are 1, however some of them are 2, meaning that in this case the player must be able to place 2 roads. If he can only place 1, he cannot perform the action, and he cannot play the card except than discarding it to get $2. Some cards depict a range multiplier, like in this one here, which means that the player may select the number of times he will perform this action, that must be of course within that range. Usually these cards have the same multiplier in their bottom part, which means that what they get depends on how many times they perform the top action. In this example, the player may remove 1 to 3 upright workers from the board to the main supply. For each worker the player removes, he will gain $2. So if he removes 2 workers, then he will gain $4 from the supply. Let's explain some more icons in the bottom part of cards. Yes, this one is the icon of dollars. This circular icon is very important as it symbolizes reputation gains. In the bottom part of cards, we normally see icons of resources. If these resources have a space among them, like in this case here, then the player must pay or gain all the depicted resources. So here, the player must pay a grape and a stone. When we have a group of resources that are connected to each other, like here, it means that the player has to pay or gain one of the depicted resources. If there's an exclamation mark in the group, this means that the player will gain or pay the resource that is connected to where he performed the action. So in this case, the player will gain the resource that is connected to the hex where he moved his worker in the action part. And if he moved 2 workers or 1 worker for 2 spaces, he will gain that bonus twice. If there is a question mark, then the player chooses which resource he will gain or pay from this group. If we have this icon of inequality, then this means that the player must pay resources that are different. So here the player must pay 2 of the depicted resources, but not the same. A great percentage of the cards in the game work like that. However, there are some more special cards like this one here, which has no action to be performed, just 3 benefits groups for the player to choose from. As I said, all cards in the game are different. However, I will explain the 5 starting cards, which are the same for all players, so that you know how to begin. The player's starting cards have 3 identical cards, 3 farmers, so I will start from these. The card instructs the player to place a worker from the supply on any undeveloped hexagon on the board that must be adjacent to any 1 or more workers that are already on the board. If there were no other workers on the board, then the player could choose any 1 undeveloped hexagon. However, in our example we have 4 workers on the board, so the new one has to be placed in a hexagon that is adjacent to one of those. The selected hex must be undeveloped, so all these hexes are excluded. Then the player gains 1 of the depicted resources, grapes, grains or stone, exclamation mark, so it depends on where the player will place his worker. So if he placed it here, he will gain 1 grapes. The card also depicts crocodiles, so if there is a crocodile on the hex, then the player removes it and gains $1 from the supply. So this player has gained a grape and $1 for this placement. The next card is 2 roads. With this card, the player must be able to place 2 roads on the board, connecting spaces with no crocodiles, so a player could not place this road here. The roads don't have to be continuous. You can place 1 road here and 1 road there. If the player placed 1 road here, he would connect 2 settlements for first time, so he would also gain 1 reputation point. He cannot place the second road here, as this is branching and it can only happen in settlements or building site spaces. If the player builds his roads like that, he will connect this settlement with this building site, but these are already connected, so he would not gain the reputation bonus. In our example, the player finally chooses to place 1 road here and 1 road there. Then the player must pay 2 resources, 1 for each road placed. The resource must match 1 of the 2 hexes that each road connects. This road connects grapes with grapes, so I definitely have to pay one grapes. And the second one connects grapes with stone, so I can choose whether I pay a stone or a grape for the second road. Of course, I could pay roses instead of these resources, and I could also pay with 3 coins instead of any one of these resources. After payment of costs, the player gains 3 reputation points plus 1 for connecting the 2 settlements. The last starting card is Settlement. With this card, the player places 1 settlement from the supply to any hexagon with no crocodiles. This cannot be a hexagon that contains another settlement or a workshop or a building site. However, it could contain a worker, which will remain at the space. Then the player pays 1 grain, 1 stone and 1 grape in order to gain 3 reputation points and $3 from the bank. Now, the box contains a card reference booklet explaining all cards in the game. I don't advise you to go and read this through before playing. However, what you can do is each time you draw a new card, go in here and read the explanation. After a couple of games, you won't have any use for that. The second option a player has on his turn is to buy a card from the current market, which is the 4 cards here. The player must pay a cost in dollars, which is depicted below the cards, and if there is a -1 token on the card, then the player gets that discount. So if, for example, the player wants to buy this card, he must pay 4 coins to the supply, he places the -1 token next to the space and gains the card. The card the player buys goes to the player's hand. Finally, the player must replenish the empty space on the market by drawing the top card from the stack. This card must be placed in numerical order among the other cards. This card has the number 38, so its position is here, between 34 and 58. This means that the player will push the rest cards here to make space for the new card. So this placement has pushed card number 34 in the current market, making it available for buying by other players. Make sure to always keep the numerical order of these 8 cards at all times. In administration, we'll just have to explain the process depicted on the administration card. So when a player chooses administration for his turn, he performs the following steps in the order depicted on the card. First, the player gains $3 from the supply, but 1 less for each card still remaining in his hand. So this player, for example, will gain only $1. Next, the player may remove 0 to 2 upright workers from anywhere on the board, returning them back to the supply, gaining $1 for each removed worker. Let's say the player removes this one and this worker and gains $2 from the supply. Then the player takes back the top 3 cards from his discard stack, if he has enough. After that, the player may continue taking back cards, paying $1 for each card. So the player can spend $1 and take another card, and then spend another one to gain another card. This can be done unlimited number of times, provided the player has enough dollars and enough cards in his discard pile. In the last step of administration, the player removes a certain number of cards from the market, replacing them with new cards from the stack. The number of cards replaced depends on the number of players in the game. In a 2 or 3 player game, you have to remove 2 cards, but in a 4 or 5 players game, you have to remove just 1 card. When you remove cards, you have to remove the cards with the lowest number in the top, giving priority to cards that have a discount token. In my example of a 3 players game, I have to remove 2 cards. The 2 cards with the lowest value on top are these 2, 8 and 10. But since there is another card with a discount token, I have to remove this one first. Then the second one will be the card with the lowest number. Discarded cards are removed from the game. Next, you need to add a discount token to each remaining card in the current market that doesn't have a discount token. So you have to place 2 markers here. Finally, you refill the empty spaces in the market using the same way as you do when the player buys a card from the market. As soon as the normal card stack depletes, continue drawing cards from the final turn stack. This stack contains normal action cards, but also 4 natural disasters with numbers from 122 to 128. After the 4th natural disaster is placed in the market, this triggers the end of the game. After this point, no player may take an administration turn. They may only play a card or buy a card from the market. Additionally, players may now quit the game intentionally when it's their turn. However, if a player cannot play a card from his hand, or he cannot buy one, then he must quit the game. Whenever a player quits the game, he takes a natural disaster card from the board that depicts the highest number of reputation points and scores them immediately. When all players have quit, the player higher in the reputation track wins the game. In case of a tie, then the tied player with the most resources in hand wins the game. So that was Faiyum. You can call me a traditional guy, but this game enters my game collection by all means. We have deep strategy with simple mechanics accessible to everyone. So, if you liked our video and want to see more, please subscribe to my channel, and until next time, have fun and play more board games.